All right, I see Denver, I see Maui. Once again, guys, we're just taking a couple of minutes here. We're gonna let everyone, give everyone a chance to hop on the call. Today's webinar, there we go. New York, Rhode Island. Once again, today's webinar is focused on how to stay in business. This is survival tactics for artists and galleries. We are taking questions in today's webinar. So we're gonna do some questions. There is a Q&A button you should see on your browser. I see I've got a couple of questions popped in already. Some people have sent me questions over the last day or two via email. So I've taken those down. We'll be answering those toward the end of today's call. We've got California, we've got Flat Rock. Hello to Melanie, hello to Annie, El Dorado Hills. Just so everyone knows, my name is Dale Dobolowski. I'm the Digital Operations Manager here at Streamline Publishing. What that means, I handle all the websites and delivery of our online art instruction, as well as any online events such as this. I'm gonna be moderating the call today, once again, taking some of your questions that you guys have that you're gonna be posting. We'll try to take all the questions in the Q&A box. You should see a button at the bottom of your panel. The chat, let's try to keep we'll ask some questions throughout the presentation and we'll get some answers in the chat, but that seems to be flying by way too fast for me to keep a handle on. So I'll do my best to answer anything in there, but we'll keep questions through the Q&A tab. If right now is a good time to silence your cell phone and make sure you're comfortable. Today's webinar will run about an hour. And if you're having any, right now is a good time, if you've got people in the house who are on Netflix or doing any streaming like that, if you do experience any issues with your stream, make sure you kick those folks off to preserve the bandwidth for this stream. But that is about it for me. We're gonna kick off the webinar. Once again, Q&A, questions into the Q&A panel, and we'll get to those toward the end of the session. You guys all know Eric Rhoads, or most of you know Eric Rhoads. He's been doing daily Facebook lives from his Facebook page. And that is probably where many of you have heard about this webinar today. Eric Rhoads is an art publisher. He's the publisher of PleinAir Magazine and Fine Art Connoisseur Magazine. He's the president and CEO of Streamline Publishing. You guys may know things that we do, art events and art instruction. And Eric is the head of all of that. Eric is a well-known art marketer and he's here with us today to do a presentation for us all on how to stay in business, survival for artists and galleries. So here he is, Eric Rhoads.
Hi guys, thank you all for coming in and I'm gonna try to figure out how to turn this slide off. Bear with me for just a second. And I am not able to do that for some reason. And anyway, we're gonna be talking today. You don't need to see me. You've seen me too many times before. So we're gonna talk today about artist and gallery survival. Now, what I'm gonna tell you today isn't gonna make you very happy. I am not necessarily gonna give you a lot of good news. This is not a time to sugarcoat anything. This is a time to tell you some things that you might not want to hear. And I hope that's okay, because I think that we all need to put on our big boy and big girl pants. And this is a time when we have to survive. Somebody gave me a little bit of a hard time about the idea that extinction is possible. Maybe that's a little harsh, but I think the thing that we have to keep in mind is that this is an event that has never happened before in the history of America, certainly not modern times. We've had pandemics, but we never had a pandemic with a shutdown. And this is a world shutdown. We don't know what this is going to look like. And so I don't want to have you return to a job that you don't love if you're a full-time artist. If you're a gallery owner, I don't want to have you get another job because your gallery has gone bankrupt. I believe, honestly, I believe that art will continue to sell, but I don't think as much art is going to sell. That means the people who are in the right place at the right time are going to have the big advantage. And we're going to talk about that. And so everything I'm going to say today is pointed to both of you, the artist and gallery. Now, there are people who are probably tuned in who may own small businesses or may have other entrepreneurial things, and these things will apply to you as well. Now, we've had over 3,000 people try to sign up for this, and I'm already losing my voice. What am I going to do? had over 3,000 people sign up for this, and obviously, there's always a pretty high number of people who never show up for webinars. I know I sign up for them all the time, and then I get busy and I don't show up, sign up. But we will be sending them a replay of this so that they have the opportunity to see it again if need be. So I'll just tell you briefly that Dale kind of covered it. By the way, applause to Dale. Thank you, Dale. It's hard for me to believe that I've been in business over 50 years, but I have, and that's because I started out when I was a pretty young kid in the radio business, started my first business when I was 12 years old. Actually, if you go back further, I started my first business when I was 8. It wasn't very successful. But I've been in a fairly legitimate business for at least the last 30 or 40 years, and I have survived 4 different recessions. And I barely survived them. I got to tell you that I am not any different than anybody else. We have, we learn things. The first couple of recessions were really, really tough. And by the time I got around to the third one, I had figured it out. And so what I'm going to tell you today is some stuff that I figured out. Over the past really past part of my career, I've been marketing for literally hundreds of brands. I was in the radio broadcasting industry. I was on television. I crafted ad campaigns for companies. I've taken small, little bitty independent retail companies and turned them into big, giant, multiple outlet companies. And I started art marketing about 15 years ago. And the way it happened is that I started the magazines. PleinAir Magazine was the first magazine, first art magazine. And I started hearing more and more from people who would say, hey, can you give me some ideas on marketing? Could you coach me? Would you become my manager, et cetera? And so I started Art Marketing Bootcamp, which I do live at the PleinAir Convention every year. And now I do live sessions at the Figurative Art Convention every year. And so I also have a blog, which is artmarketing.com. And I have coached and advised a lot of galleries and artists over the years. I do not actually do that for a living. I turn people down when they ask me to do that because I simply don't have the bandwidth to do it. And quite frankly, I'd love to help everybody, but I can't. So that's why I'm doing things like this to try and help you. I'm a passionate art collector. I've been collecting art for a long time, and I'm also an artist. I do sell my work. I don't sell a lot of work. I don't have a lot of time to produce a lot of work, but I pretty much sell what I make. And then, as Dale mentioned, I'm with Fine Art Connoisseur, PleinAir, Fine Art Today, PleinAir Today, Realism Today, and American Watercolor. All right. So my goal in life is to prevent the idea of the starving artist. We have romanticized Van Gogh and the hell that he went through, and he only sold 2 paintings in his entire lifetime, and we don't want to be that. Now, I will tell you that I went out to dinner a couple of years ago with one of the artists who was at the PleinAir convention, and he picked me up in his brand new top of the line Mercedes-Benz. And during conversation, he was telling me about his home in this place and then this place and in this place. And this guy, it turned out, was a multimillionaire. And I was really surprised. I knew he would be successful. I had no idea how successful he was. I think the goal here should be to help you live your dream, whatever your dream is. Some of you don't care about becoming a multimillionaire. I don't care about that either. My goal is quality of life. My goal is being able to have freedom and not to be able to have to make choices. You know, I'm best working for myself. I don't do well working for others. And So I don't want to have to go back working for others. I've been there, done that. I didn't like it at the time. I don't want to go back. Many of you are artists. I remember somebody telling me they had a job as a bookkeeper or an accountant or something, and every day they hated going into work. And as soon as they could, they got to the point where they could become a full-time artist. And they never, their driver was they never wanted to go back to that. So that's what we're going to try and help you avoid. Of course, we don't want any starving galleries either. Now, I want to talk about the Great Depression. First off, we all assume a lot of things about the Great Depression. I have the benefit of parents who grew up in the Great Depression. My father is still living. He is in his mid-90s. And he tells me a lot about the Great Depression and the things that they went through, but also some of the things that we never hear about. First off, there was a new wealthy class of people. Whenever there's a shift in the economy, whenever there's something that goes wrong, there are people who go from being regular people to becoming wealthy people. And a great example of that was bankruptcy attorneys back then. A lot of bankruptcy attorneys became very wealthy, but there you will see, even in this time that we're going through now, you're going to see a lot of companies, a lot of people who are going to innovate and come up with new things that are solving big problems for people, and they will become wealthy. Wealthy people are wealthy people at different times. And so what I mean by that is that even wealthy people in a bad economy are going to go out and buy new cars and buy new houses and decorate their houses. The people who are ultra wealthy are still going to always do that. I remember a story from a gallery friend of mine in New York who said, look, I said, are the rich people still buying paintings? Because he sold $500,000 paintings. He said, yeah, they're not buying $500,000 paintings. They're kind of only buying $50,000 and $60,000 paintings to put in their kitchen, but they're still buying paintings. And I think that's the one thing that we should remember is that just because you and I are in a situation where we're feeling a little overwhelmed by all of this and maybe don't have any money right now, or maybe are really worried about our, you know, our 401k or our savings or whatever, just understand that not everybody is in the same place we are. The class was spending, and yes, a lot of them were seeking bargains. A lot of people bought, when they had made a lot of money, they bought a lot of real estate that people would sell for 10 cents on the dollar and became massive landlords. Some of the biggest landlords in New York are because their grandfathers or grandmothers bought tons of property when they had some cash and they were able to buy things from other people. But the one thing that happened is that major brands stopped advertising, and that's already happening here in this environment. And there were startup brands that became new leaders, like Kellogg's, for instance. Now, in 1973, well, I think I'll go back. I'm not sure I had that slide, but Kellogg's, just to tell you that story real quickly, Post cereals was the number one cereal, had a 90% market share in the Great Depression. When the Great Depression happened, they said, we're going to cut all advertising and save money because we're laying off people, we're concerned about sales. So they did that. They saved money. And a startup, meanwhile, Kellogg's came along and started advertising. Now, Kellogg's was brand new, hardly had any meat on their bones. And Post board of directors met and they talked and they said, you know, there's a startup out there that's advertising. They said, look, we're so big. If, you know, they might take a point or two away from us, they're not going to take too much away from us. And so they ignored it. And Kellogg, by the end of the Great Depression, was the number one brand and had the majority of the market share of cereal, and Post never regained their lead. The point of that is that a recession, a depression, is an opportunity. And I want you to look at this not only about survival and preventing extinction, I want you to look at this as opportunity. Now, in 1973, which I was present at, we had gas lines. There was no gas. We had days where we, you know, one day a week or 2 days a week, depending on our last name, the letter in our last name, we could go get gas. In that period of time, Toyota Corolla was behind Honda, and Honda was below VW. And VW and Honda decided to both stop advertising during the 73 recession. Toyota doubled down. They continued their advertising, and when everybody else reduced or stopped, they became the top import in America by 1976. They never stopped. They've never lost that lead. So in the 1990 recession, Pizza Hut and Taco Bell took advantage of McDonald's, who stopped advertising. Pizza Hut increased by 61%. Taco Bell increased by 40%. McDonald's declined by 28%. That's a huge chunk. And so there's opportunity in all of this, whether you're an artist or a gallery. Now, in 2008, Amazon kind of had the perfect storm. People were not, you know, buying a lot online yet, but Amazon doubled down to bring attention to themselves. You see this photo, they didn't even have the logo they have now. And they grew in 2009. They were able to buy advertising cheaper. In 2009, they grew by 28%. Of course, now, of course, they dominate. Now, and also, I'm not going to use a name here because I don't have permission, but I have a friend that owned a gallery, and he and his wife launched their gallery in 2008 at the beginning of the recession. This man had been a financial advisor, had been someone who knew about recessions and the opportunity. And he actually told me that he waited and did not launch his gallery until he knew the recession was hitting. He launched it. He had it all ready. His competitors stopped advertising. I know because I was selling advertising at the time, and I'm trying to talk people into hanging on to their advertising, and they weren't doing it. Even though there were fewer people who were buying art from those other galleries, what happened is when they stopped advertising, they were out of sight and out of mind. And as a result, the galleries who were advertising, the artists who were advertising, were still getting business. This guy, even though that maybe each gallery only had 10% of the sales it would have had by getting 10% from gallery A and 10% from B and C and D and so on, he ended up having the best year in 2008-2009 after launching his gallery. Because first, think about this. During a recession, most people stop advertising. And so I know that's happened to us to some extent, and our pages are thinner. So the people who are in there are going to stand out more. And of course, right now, during this time, people have time. And so they're reading more, they're spending more time. So this gallery became dominant by advertising. So the lessons from recessions is that most people cut their advertising and marketing. This resulted in them getting zero buyers, forcing them out of business. And see what happens, we don't realize is that there's a thing called momentum. And when you have momentum, you've spent a lot of years getting to where you are, and you think that if you stop and then you come back, it's just going to come back. But when you lose momentum and you stay out of sight, you have to claw to get back, and it's really hard. So it's the people who continued marketing who captured buyers and became leading brands. Now, we're going to talk today about this. There are artists out there that we all know and galleries we know who are considered the top brands. And a time like this will actually establish new artists and new galleries as leading brands. Galleries and artists that mostly disappear will mostly disappear from everywhere other than social media. And you're assuming wrongly, I believe, that social media is going to reach the right people. The reality is that most people don't reach the right people on social media. You certainly can design it that way. But most artists I know have mostly other artists on their sites. They're not employing the basic important principles of marketing, which I'll talk about. And as a result, social media is not enough. You know, in an environment, let's say an environment like Fine Art Connoisseur, where we've got all these billionaire readers, you stay in front of them, it's a different animal because those billionaire readers aren't following you on Instagram. Most people will cut back on everything, and usually it's advertising first. In the advertising environment, there's less noise, which we talked about, and those who brand heavily for the next 12 to 18 months are going to gain much more traction than anybody who normally advertises, because you're competing with fewer people and competing with less noise. So the people who are branding themselves will become the new top brands, the new Richard Schmidt's and the new CW Mundy's. And there's a whole lot to branding, and I can't get into a lot of that today, but you know, these people are brilliant branders. Now, we have right now what I consider to be a home advantage, and that is that the quarantine is creating a need to fill time. People are increasing their media time, their reading time, their time online. They're spending more time with publications, more time on TV, and they're becoming bored buyers. My wife said to me, you know, I just can't wait to go out and buy something. So she's been going online and buying a couple things, not a lot because we're not spending a lot of money right now. In our case, we've been posting daily videos, art instruction video samples at 3 o'clock on Facebook every day for 30 days. We've seen in the last 29 days, we saw 1.7 million views, more views than we've ever seen possible in our history. So this is a time to take advantage of this quarantine. Of course, it's not going to last for long everywhere. It's going to last longer in some areas. So now's your best time to get attention from potential buyers. They'll give you more time. And this is the best time to cement relationships with existing buyers. So one of the first action items I hope you're taking notes, is I want you to spend time on Zoom or on the phone and deepen your relationships with the buyers that you have. If you're an art gallery, you need to be talking to your past customers every day. And you don't necessarily need to be calling them and saying, hey, I want you to buy some art. What I want you to do is to check in with them, see if they're okay, offer to help them in any way. And you know, they might ask about art and you can talk to them about it. You can say what's happening, be truthful about what's happening in your gallery. They might ask you if you have anything special or any special discounts, and you might want to talk about that. But this is the time to deepen relationships. Same for you, artists. It's deepening relationships with your galleries, deepening with the buyers that you have. Hopefully you have created your list over time. So specific actions to branding is, don't assume social media is your answer. Size and frequency send signals of success. You want to make sure people know you're still in business, know you're out there, that you need to be visible. One of the reasons I'm doing Facebook every day is because I want to remain visible during this period of time. And I think on the other side of that, there may be some benefit. You know, I might be able to grow my business on the other side of that. And then you want to always concentrate on what you can dominate and not spread too thin. We're going to talk about that in a minute, but you want to dominate something because you can't dominate everything. Nobody can afford to dominate everything unless you're Coca-Cola or somebody like that. So I'm going to talk about a couple of principles, and I'm going to talk about questions. The one thing that I think is very important for all of us, if we're running a business, and if you're selling art, you're running a business, whether you're at a gallery or whether you're an artist who's selling, is that the questions provide the answers to your business. I'm a member of a board of directors. My board of directors made up about 15 different people. I'm on their board, they're on my board, and we work together and we have a chairman of our board. And that chairman of our board says to us, you need to have thinking time 2 times a week for at least 1 hour. That means you stop everything, you ask yourself questions, and you think about your business. And if you don't do that, then you're reacting. You're not being proactive. But most of us don't stop and think about our business. The problem we have right now is that in this environment, you know, we can say, look, this is a horrible thing. But if you're in the midst of a hurricane and you're cursing at the wind because your house has fallen down, and you know, you can go out and curse in the hurricane and it's going to blow you away. It's not going to do any good. That's not going to ensure your survival. Wishful thinking isn't going to work right now. You got to take some very tough actions. There are only 2 possible outcomes for you in this scenario: survival or stability. I guess the third outcome is extinction, right? We don't want that. So 2 possible outcomes for you. Survival means having dry powder, meaning it as much cash as you possibly can avoid spending. Keep your cash dry. Now, that may mean making some unpopular decisions. I had to lay off 20% of my staff to be able to survive this, and hopefully I'll be able to survive it. And at the same time, I didn't want to lay them off. I was wishful thinking. I hoped that things would get better. But quite frankly, if I would have waited any longer, I would have had to lay off more people. And so I'm glad that I didn't wait. And I hope to get those people back as soon as I can. But so you've got two outcomes. You want survival or at least stability, where at least you're cash neutral. So here's a question that you've got to ask yourself. And this is not so much a marketing question, but it's a business question. I'm going to ask a few business questions for a minute. And that is, how much are my cash reserves and how do I make sure that I'm not depleting them with excess spending? You got to stop your spending. No one knows how long this is going to last, how deep things are going to go, or when the economy or the art economy is going to rebound. Nobody knows that. I don't know it. I think I'm an expert on art marketing, but I don't know the answer. I don't know if the virus is going to return. I don't know how this getting out of the quarantine is going to work. We don't know. Some people say this is going to be going on for a year or longer. Some people say it's going to be over fast. We don't know. And so don't operate on hope. Keep your cash dry. I guarantee you that the art business isn't going to look the same as it did when we were on the other side of this. Everything's going to change. Everything will change in some way. We're, for instance, a lot of us are working from home. Now, I've worked from home for 20 years. When email came about, I said, you know what? I'm not paying rent anymore. That's crazy. We had a whole floor of an office building. We saved all that money all these years. Hundreds of businesses are going to realize that and say, you know what? My employees are working from home. It's working out. They hate commuting. They're happier. They're working harder. They get two more hours a day because they're not commuting. And everybody's better. And so things are going to change in a lot of businesses. There will be differences in the way that you communicate with customers, differences in the way that you deliver artwork. You know, you look at the ads on TV now for Domino's Pizza or for various organizations, and they're talking about how once the pizza's out of the oven, we don't touch it. No human hand touches it. We deliver it to your door, but, you know, we drop it off, that kind of a thing. There will be differences. We don't know what those business differences are yet, but you want to ask yourself, how will my art business need to adjust to new consumer expectations after the crisis? And it will change. We just don't know what it will be. So optimism and emotion are going to result in hanging on too long, not cutting deep enough or fast enough. And if you are in a business, especially a gallery business, and you're hanging on to employees, I get it. I want those people to stay working, but everybody's going to be gone and out of work if you don't save your money. So do what you can to stretch. Now, the other thing is optics and flexibility and speed are mandatory. You know, when Kobe Bryant died, and I hate to use this as an example, but that was pilot error because the pilot was flying in through the fog by looking out the window. He was not looking at the radar and he didn't have the right kind of equipment in his helicopter, and he should have not taken off, but he slammed into a mountain because he couldn't see. You have to have optics to get through this. You know, how up to date are your optics? You know, are you looking at your numbers? Do you really understand your numbers? Do you understand how much cash you have? Do you understand your cost of living? Can you figure out ways to be flexible and change that and spend less money? And also, speed is critical. You've got to be fast. We're working harder than ever and faster than ever because we've got to survive. Now, your accounts receivable, if you're a gallery business, most of you who are artists aren't this way, but your accounts receivable or somebody else's accounts payable. I know that you're going to use this against me, but don't rush to accelerate your payments. Preserve your cash. If you can delay paying things by an extra 30 days or 15 days, do it. Do the best you can. This is survival time. Also, think about the chess grandmaster who's always thinking 20 moves into the future. Novices don't do that. So you've got to be asking yourself, what's likely to happen? What happens if we have more shutdowns or slower recovery or no recovery? How do you get through this? Try to come up with every possible scenario and then come up with answers for your particular business. Now, one thing I want you to be thinking about is, what's my new message and my new promise, and how is that going to be relevant to my target audience based on how life has changed instantly? You know, the gallery business might be we find something online, we'll drop it off at your house on your front door, call you so you can pick it up, hang it up in your house and try it for a couple of months. If you like it, you know, here's how we're going to pay for it. Or it might be, you know, no human contact. But it may not be the fact that you even need that gallery building. You know, I'm in a gallery in Fort Wayne, Indiana, which is in this beautiful castle, beautiful old home. They may not be able to have customers there for a year or 2 years. And if they can't, you know, they have to pay for that building. Some of you have rent. You may not need that rent anymore. The other thing I want you to think about is think about the COVID situation right now. You go into an emergency room, and in an emergency room, these people are running fast. They're checking things fast. They're really scrambling. They're working on saving lives, right? They're not going up to somebody and saying, listen, you need to, you know, get more exercise and lower your cholesterol and change your diet. That's not the kind of thing right now. This is what you need to be doing. You not need to be working on your diet right now. You need speed, you need information, and you need to be intense. The intensity is what's going to save you. You need to double your intensity right now. If you're painting more and marketing less, you should reverse that. Market more, do more business, do more business calls. This is the time to save your business. Now, where are there opportunities for me to eliminate my distractions and refocus? I showed a chart on my Facebook the other day about relevance in coronavirus times. I should have put it in here, but the idea was my car was relevant 3 months ago, but today my car is not relevant. I'm not using it. Cash was not all that relevant to me 3 months ago. I had some savings, but I didn't really need it. Now I wish I had more savings. It's more relevant. So there are things that you do now that you need to be focusing on and things that you don't need to be focusing on that will change. For instance, if you have inventory of paintings right now, making more paintings might make you feel better, but it's not going to solve your problem. You need to be figuring out to focus on the things that are going to solve your problem. So take control like your life depends on it, because it does. What do I need to do to ensure my survival and stability is what you need to be asking yourself. The first thing is you have to increase your visibility fast. Increase your visibility everywhere you possibly can. Look for ways to rebrand yourself, to get your brand out there more, because that's going to have a huge impact. Secondly, I know this sounds crazy, avoid offering discounts. If people ask for them and you feel comfortable taking them, do it. But avoid offering discounts, because you need every bit of cash, and you're assuming that people need discounts because you need them. Don't assume that. There may be people out there who are fine. I was talking to somebody the other day. He said, when we order takeout, we're doing 100% tip. If the bill is $50, we're leaving a $50 tip because we're trying to help people. You know, there are people out there who are willing to pay full price, so don't automatically offer a discount. Thirdly, apply for stimulus money. On our website, Dale, maybe you can chime in and tell us, but there is one of our websites we have where it shows stimulus money that's available for artists from various organizations. You might also be able to get stimulus money. We've applied for it. We haven't gotten it yet, but we think we're close. If you can get stimulus money, grab it, take it, use it, because you need it every bit. Next is use it for visibility. You hear about all these people who are getting their stimulus check in the mail, their personal stimulus check, and they're going out and buying a new TV or ordering a new TV online. No, use that to work on your future, build your business. You know, if you get a $1,200 check in the mail, ask yourself, how can I apply that $1,200 to make sure that I'm more visible, to make sure that I have more customers? I want you to assume, this hurts, I want you to assume a 60% loss of your customer list. Now, there's a thing called attrition. In any particular given year, let's say you're a gallery, I'll use a gallery in this case, but it's true for an artist too. In any particular year, you lose 10% of your customers. I lose 10% of my customers. They die, they move, they downsize, they get sick, they can't buy art, they don't have any money anymore. During the 2009 recession, most galleries lost 60% of their customer base, 60% dropped off. Now, in a typical year, when you're dropping off 10%, I say, look, you have to be fishing to get 10% more new people in the door every single day, or every single month, every single year. You got to have 10% more people, because you've got to replace those and develop those as customers. During the recession, one of the reasons so many galleries went away is that they didn't replace those 60%. They assumed those people could still buy. You got to go fishing for new customers. You got to find ways to attract them into you and build your list. In this recession, we don't know how long it's going to last, but I think you should assume it's going to be at least like the last one. There could be a 60% loss. You need to be building your customer list now. Also, employ a list building strategy to replace that 60%, right? And list building strategies have to do with offering something on your website, emailing something out to people, although you've already got something on your email list, but putting it out on social media, advertising it, you know, get my free book, my free ebook, do something to get new list people. And then you've got to start grooming those new customers. Now, just because somebody joins your list doesn't mean they're going to become a new customer. You have to build trust. I always say in Art Marketing Bootcamp, you don't meet somebody for the first time at a cocktail party and ask them for $100 10 minutes later. But if you get to know them, you develop the relationship over a year and you say, hey, can you loan me $100? They will. And so the idea is you've got to start working and developing and grooming those customers, getting to know them, getting them to trust you. I'm talking fast. The other thing you've got to do is you've got to seek massive publicity now. And that's visibility, that's publicity. If you're an artist in a local market, the news people are desperate for stories. They can't go out and look for them. Send them a press release. Talk about what you're doing in creating art, or how you're developing art, or how you're doing selling art online, or do something to create publicity. It'll make a huge difference. Now, look onto your list. If you have a list, find every person who bought something in the last 3 years. After 3 years, they're probably not active buyers. Anybody who bought something in the last 3 years can be converted to a buyer now, or at least a lot of them can be. Get in their face twice a month with mail, a postcard, mail, send them a letter, get images in front of them twice a month. And you will find that after about 3 months, people will start saying, hey, I'd like to buy that painting, they'll go to your website and buy something. It takes about 3 to 6 months, depending on how often you do it. We do this in we call it Art Marketing in a Box. And we have a system, and we have artists who doubled their sales in 1 year by following this protocol, but also some more emails, some more frequently. The idea is you want to get contact with people. Right now is the best time to get contact. You need to increase your ad spend. This is not the time to drop off. Whatever you're advertising in, increase it. I bought radio ads. I'm on a national network trying to drive people to a website we have about learning to paint. Now, it's hard for me to know that I had to lay off people, but I also know that if I don't advertise, I'm in trouble. So I'm advertising. I'm advertising in a lot of other places. We're contacting other publications we advertise in and doubling down, increasing. And of course, it's a good time to negotiate. Now, I want to talk about this. This is called momentum. And every business has momentum. Dale, I'm just going to tell you, I'm going to run a little long on this. So those of you who wanted to drop out for the 3 p.m. broadcast, just know that there will be a replay of that. But every business has what's called a product life cycle. The introduction period, your business is pretty flat and just starts growing pretty slowly. And sometimes that introduction period is 3 or 4 years. Sometimes it's 10 years. It just depends. Then you go through these moments where you have a growth spurt. In my particular business, I was in business for 20 years and I was still in that introduction phase. I had some growth, but not massive growth. Then I changed something about my business, which I won't get into today, and I started seeing massive growth for the last 5 years. At some point, I'll get to the point where growth, I'm not seeing much more growth, and then things are stable. But if I don't reinvent my business at the top of that maturity curve, it will go into decline. And the same is true for you. So you have to have product extensions or new products or reinvention at that maturity level so that you can continue, so that curve goes into a new introduction phase, but you're already still high, so your sales are not lost. Now, look at this. Let's assume that this has been a pretty good economy up till now. Let's assume you're right here on the product life cycle and you're still in growth, you're doing pretty well, and you're feeling pretty good about things. Now look what happens. You were here, you stop your advertising, you say, you know, I just gotta not do anything. What that does is the minute you're out of sight, it doesn't take long. Next thing you know, especially with the economy the way it is, next thing you know, you drive yourself back to the low introduction stage somewhere else. And what you really wanna do is save your business. Now, you may not get to as high as you were, but you've got to save your business and you want to get further up on the product life cycle. And that's why it's critical to continue to stay visible, to continue your advertising. That's really critically important. So I want to talk about advertising for a second. Which is better? Reach, meaning a lot of people, or frequency with a quality audience? The answer, excuse me, depending on what you're selling, if you're selling Coca-Cola, reach, because most people drink Coca-Cola or soft drinks. But when you're selling art, out of all those people, probably not many of them buy art, especially that demographic. But if you look over here, the demographic of the people that are in the theater, they're in tuxedos, they're well-dressed, they probably have money. So you want to be thinking about this. The yellow circles represent buyers in each crowd. We oftentimes think because it's a big crowd or a big audience that matters. You know, I remember a story that Tom Elmo told me. Tom Elmo met the circulation director from a competing art magazine. They're not in business anymore, by the way, so I won't mention their name, but he met this guy and he said, well, we really made a mistake. He said, we offered, you know, $2 subscriptions and we were able to go out and say, hey, we have 50,000 subscribers or 100,000 subscribers. And the reality is though, that most of them were people who didn't buy art. They're people who said, hey, it's a $3 subscription. And as a result, they, you know, they told people they had big audiences, but that didn't matter. What mattered was quality. Now this on the other hand, this crowd is a smaller crowd, you know, maybe 500 people, but look how many art buyers are in that. You want to target audiences that matter. Art buyers in your particular case are the people who matter, not big crowds. And there are a lot of people who love art, you know, who will buy cheap subscriptions, you know, school teachers. I love school teachers, but most of them are not buying art from other people because of their salary level, unless they happen to be married to somebody who has the money. So you always want to, I always say, stand in the stream where the money is flowing. Now, frequency is about finding a quality audience and then hitting them up multiple times. And because you've got to repeat your message. When you're teaching, you got to tell things over and over again so people remember it. And so frequency is the repetition. And I always say in marketing, repetition is what matters most. That's why I say buy what you can dominate, because if it was a matter of, okay, let's say I have $1,000 and I'll spend $200 in each of these publications, spending my $1,000, you're not going to get any results. But if you spend that $1,000 in one particular place, you get the opportunity for repetition over and over and over again, and then it changes how people respond. This is how it works. Most people, you know, you run an ad. First off, you can't assume when you run an ad that everybody sees that ad. So you run it one time and you think, oh, everybody's going to call me, and then nobody calls. Well, that's because they don't really have any awareness or trust of you yet. So you run it again, and now they're getting some trust and awareness. And you run it again, and now they're getting some interest. You run it again, now they're in the stage of desire. Gee, I'd like to own that artist or that painting or visit that gallery. You run it again, now they're thinking, maybe I'll buy something. And then you run it again, and then finally it's like, I see something I want, I'm going to buy it. And then you keep it going, because there are always different people in and out of the market at different stages. and you want to keep it going. But here's what happens. I've had this happen so many times. You have somebody say, well, I want to advertise. And so they run a couple of ads, they get some awareness, and then they think, it's not working. I'll go try another publication. So they try another publication. They say, oh, that didn't work. I'll go try another publication. So they jump around and they get nowhere. Then they come back and they say, okay, well, I decided I'm going to go back to your publication. They start again and they have to rebuild momentum. And you don't want to have to rebuild momentum. You want to grow the momentum you had. So there's no better time in the history of your business than now to build your mind share, your customer list, and interest and demand. I literally believe this. No better time in my lifetime than now. I mean, you think about this. I've had 1.7 million viewers in the past 29 days. I could have never done that because these people didn't have time. Now they're aware of us. They're aware of our products. And maybe they'll like them and buy them someday. Maybe they're not buying them now, but maybe they will someday. So it's counterintuitive to think about promoting and advertising now when, you know, you're trying to keep your cookies dry, but it's the best opportunity of your lifetime, especially even in the next 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 weeks while people are still in quarantine. Best possible time for you. Now, I teach in my art marketing boot camps, and I'm just going to touch on this. We have what I call pillars of marketing. Imagine that this gray thing at the top is the Parthenon and that these are columns. And there are various methods that you use for marketing, which is selling, social media, advertising, email promotions, events and shows, direct mail. I've got events and shows in there twice, advertising on social media, website sales, et cetera. Now imagine, I've realized that there's an 80-20%. 80% of my business comes from 20% of my marketing. It always holds true with everything. So personal selling, still there's nothing that replaced personal selling. Advertising is huge. Email promotions are huge. And events and shows can be big. But here's what's happening. A lot of people had their business based on events and shows. And guess what they can't do right now? And the Parthenon is getting ready to fall. You have to go back and replace and do some other things to stay alive. You might not be able to do events and shows for weeks or months. We don't know. We just don't know. So now I want to go to Q&A, and Dale is going to read some questions and I'll try to answer them. I'm going to try to get a lot of them in, so I'm going to be brief. So Dale, I'm going to stop sharing my screen and you take it away. If I can figure out how to stop sharing my screen.
Sounds good, Eric. Yeah, we've got a bunch of questions. A bunch came in over the last couple of days, email submitted, and then a number of them came in during this presentation. So we'll try to move as quickly as we can. We'll get through as many of the questions as we can. Anything we're not able to answer, maybe we'll follow up around after. But a couple of questions that have come in have a similar theme. Judy Mudd and Laurel Schmid both asked similar questions regarding how to adjust art pricing during an economic crash or during a time like this. Should you have a sale? Does it ultimately devalue your work? Is it a good idea to discount? And you touched on this a little bit earlier, but I think now's a good time to kind of drive that home.
Well, I think the answer to that is you have two things to ask yourself. The first one is, am I going to survive if I don't do this? And if the answer is no, the only way to survive is to do this, then if you think it'll work for you, then do it. I would say that offering a discount without someone asking is a fool's game, that there are times to do it. I'm in a survival mode. I'm offering discounts on my art instruction videos when we're doing samples. And so I'm a fool, but I have to survive. But I'm not offering, I'm offering discounts I can afford to offer, but if I were to offer much, much deeper, I would hurt myself. And you have to ask yourself, am I going to hurt myself? The other thing is you can do what's called a cash surge. I'm actually going to do an offer at the end of this, which is a cash surge, and you'll get a chance to see how that's done. But the idea is I'm trying to figure out how to help my business a little bit. And the way I'm going to do it is I'm going to offer you guys like a 75% discount on something I normally sell. And I would normally not do that. I'm not going to do it anywhere else. I'm going to do it on the webinar only, but this is the kind of thing that you could do, is you could do a cash serve. But I would recommend don't just automatically discount, because a lot of the people who are your customers don't necessarily need that discount. Next question.
Sandhya Sharma asked, with most plein air events getting canceled now or put on hold, that opportunity's lost, kind of your Parthenon example. What is the best plan of action for artists right now to generate consistent income or sales?
Sandhya, I know you very well and you're a good friend, and I'm glad you're tuning in. I think that you have to assume, first off, I hope the plein air events come back, and I think they will, because most of them are outdoors and they'll be able to social distance if needed. But in the meantime, that is a perfect example of living on a single pillar. And when that pillar got yanked out, your Parthenon came down. And so you've got to figure out, how do I reach those same people who would spend that same amount of money with me? And maybe you could put together a virtual plein air show with some friends and offer a sale. Maybe you do a paint out and you do it on video, and then you offer a sale. Maybe you come up with some way to reach out to customers. But that's the problem with not developing customer lists. When you're at a plein air show, you know, if you're allowed, I'd have a fishbowl and free drawing for something, and get business cards, because then you now are able to find out who the customers are, and then you can get them on your newsletter, offer them those kinds of things to stay in front of them. Because when you have your own media, like a newsletter is your own media, then you can control it. Now, I sell advertising. I can help you reach people that you can't possibly reach, and I can help you get in front of them over and over again, but you can't possibly reach the people that I can even offer as many times as you can reach your own list. You know, I email frequently, and that's something you can do as well within reason. And so you have to ask yourself, is there a way to build my list? That doesn't mean you stop doing it with me or with others, because we still provide that valuable service, but you then use us also not only to present your artwork, but to draw people in to your offer to get them on your list. Next question.
Okay. Similar take on that, but Terenzo Gann and Pamela Grab are both asking a question about what suggestions would you have for artists who are just entering the market? Terenzo has just started his art business full time. What are the three most important suggestions you can offer to someone who's just getting into it?
First most important suggestion is build your list. Build your list. Second most important is build your list. You know what the third most?
I think I know where this is going.
I think that look, you have to figure out how to get visible. And really, I would say number one is build your list. Number two is advertise and use the advertising to build your brand, and then use the brand building to also build your list. The brand is so important, because if, let's say that that Uncle Harry dies and leaves me $100,000. And all of a sudden I got $100,000. I'm thinking, all right, I can spend $100,000. What am I going to do with it? And, you know, I saw a piece of art 6 months ago that I really, really loved, but I saw it in a magazine. I don't remember the name of the artist, which happens all the time. And I can't remember what it was. I don't even know where to find it anymore. But now I see a piece of art right now, and it reminds me, it's similar. I like it. And that artist, I remember that artist's name. You know, it's C.W. Mundy, because C.W. Mundy has been there in front of me every single day, every single week. I see him constantly. All of a sudden I go, well, I'm going to give that $100,000 to see C.W. Mundy. Probably can't even buy a C.W. Mundy for $100,000 today. But I think the idea is that you have to stay visible. What happens is we go back to that slide, we think that we're visible when we're not, and we assume that everybody knows us because we've advertised a couple of times. You got to beat that drum constantly. They got to get to know your name. You know, it's like at movie stars, the reason that you'll see them on the cover of People magazine all the time, even in controversy, is they would rather have you talking about them, keep their name out there, than to not be visible, because the lack of visibility is death for a movie star, and it's death for an artist. So I think number one is start building your list. Your website needs to offer something like a free ebook of your best paintings, in exchange for your list, and you can tell them that you're going to send them your newsletter, and then send them your newsletter. I have a whole thing in my art marketing bootcamp about what everybody does wrong with newsletters. But I think the idea here is build a list, keep a list, and when you start getting customers, they become a special list and you have to treat them differently. I wouldn't try to get into an art gallery right away. First off, that's not necessarily the best track for everybody. And usually art galleries want people who are already famous. And so that they will see you because you're repeating yourself over and over and over again. All right, next question.
Hey, that should have answered Pam's question as well. Pam Reagan asked how to be more visible. Thank obviously, you, Pam. Once again, email list. Shelley Lethesser asked the question about stimulus resources. And there's a couple of questions about resources. And I think we'll just direct everyone to artmarketing.com/survival. Artmarketing.com/survival. I shared that in the chat a bit earlier. I'll share it again. That's got an up-to-date list that we're continuing to add to it. And the list will only continue to grow. But that's the best place to go for those types of resources for everyone.
Dale, I have a question here that I threw in from somebody sent me last night. It says, yeah. My gallery has been around for a couple of decades, but we're closed now and we hope to open soon. What should I be doing now? The answer right. to that question is first off is call everybody personally who bought a painting in the last 3 years. Call everyone, even if there's 1,000 of them, call them. You have nothing else to do. Call them up. And just say, hey, just checking in with you. How you doing? I just, you know, was thinking about you. And, you know, just create a conversation. Just have a conversation. Don't even talk about art. Don't try to sell something. Just so that the end result is, wow, that was really nice of them to call. And they didn't even try to sell me anything. I mean, they're going to remember you for that. And if they're inevitably going to bring something up. They're going to say, hey, by the way, you know, do you still have that artist in your gallery or how's business or whatever? You can be truthful. No, business is really awful, you know, or, you know, we sold a couple of things. I mean, Ray's Gallery, we did a thing with them recently. We put them on it. We did a profile. They sold almost sold out a show, I think. I want to say 8 or 10 paintings from that day we did that thing. So, you know, you want to just get in touch with people, just talk to them. If they say, hey, you got that artist, you can lead them into it. There's nothing wrong with talking to them about it, trying to sell them something, but, you know, don't make it clear. Look, I'm not calling for that right now. I value your business. I hope you'll be back. And, you know, we don't have to talk about that right now, but start that. The second thing is get your artwork in front of them. Whatever it takes. You could say, you can call somebody and say, hey, by the way, I remember you bought that Jeremy Lipkin painting and it was so beautiful. I've got one that's sitting in the gallery. The gallery's closed. Nobody's enjoying it. If you want, I'll drop it off at your house. You can hang it up for the next couple of months until the gallery's open. And, you know, no charge for that. You know, just thought you'd like and you'd enjoy it because I know you like his work. And then, you know, after a couple months, they it might grow on them and they might say, hey, by the way, would you sell that to me? If you've got 100 paintings sitting in the gallery right now, those 100 paintings will do you more good sitting in your 100 best collectors' homes. And maybe they'll buy them, maybe they won't. It's going to be a little extra work for you, but so what? All right, Dale, you got a question?
Hey, Brian has a good question. Brian Fenzel. Fenkel, what are your thoughts about how to balance financial security and the kind of risk-taking and investment required to grow an art business in the next 6 to 12 months?
Well, no business grows without risk. Brian, I went 7 years living on basically peanut butter and celery and no income to build my business. The first 7 years were really, really, really tough.
Very popular with your wife.
I was fortunate that I had a wife that was working and so that helped, but you know, we struggled. And it just, you know, you never get anywhere without taking a risk. And I don't necessarily risk, you know, recommend risking at all. But I had made some money. I sold some radio stations. I made some money. I invested it all in another thing that I tried to build and I lost everything. I lost over $1 million. And then all of a sudden I had nothing. The only thing I had was experience and education from that experience. But you know, would I do it again? I probably would, because now that I know what I know, I probably could have made it work. I think that you want to, you've got to take some risk. You want to be smart about it. You want to have a plan and have a backup. But you know, the most important thing anybody can do in building their business is to, number one, is to solve a problem. Now, in art, it's tough to say we're solving a problem, but we are. We're solving a problem of wall space. We're solving a problem of needing to be surrounded by beauty. But you solve a problem, that's the number one thing. But the next number one thing, if there is a next number one, is that you have to be seen. My friend Roy Williams talks about this all the time. He says, if you have a business and you're trying to save money on rent, so you buy, you get a little office space or gallery space, you know, in a small shopping center somewhere, and there's no traffic in it. He said, you're not ever going to make any money. He says, you pay 10 times the rent next to a Walgreens, or next to, in your case, next to a Neiman Marcus or something, you're going to have 100 times more sales, because rent is the best advertising. The idea is, you've got to stay visible. You have to have traffic, or you have to have people visiting your website. Everything you do should be spent on driving people to view your artwork and to see you. And keep in mind that you got to go where there are audiences that already are buying art. The problem with social media, I love social media. I use it. I do a lot of advertising on social media, but I know how to do it. Most people don't. And I'm looking for the audiences that are very specific to my need. And I have to try very hard to do it. I use an ad agency to do it because I don't know how to do it myself. And the idea is that you've got to reach the people who are standing in the river flowing money, right? So you've got to, I've got, you know, my magazines like Plein Air and Fine Art Connoisseur. I mean, I got a lot of people with money who buy paintings all the time in those. And so do a lot of other publications, my competitors. And those people will do you more good than trying to be cheap about it and trying to figure out how to reach somebody on your own. Because when you're cheap about it, and by the way, I've gone that route too, but I finally learned my lesson. I finally learned, it took me a long time, that I mentioned that I've figured out how to get my business on fire. I started spending a lot of money on advertising. All of a sudden it took off. It took me a lot of years to figure that out. Anyway.
That should have answered Ellen Sinclair's question again, which came in, which is how to reach a higher income market, how to reach those types of clients. So that,
well, let me just talk about that. For
sure.
A minute.
Yeah.
A lot of artists are, first off, all artists for the most part, I'd say, are really, really wonderful, caring people. And I had an artist at Fall Color Week last 2 years ago in Canada. I just said to everybody, listen, we have some time on our hands. I'd be happy to give advice. And so a lot of people signed up, and I spent an hour with each of them and gave them some advice. And one of the guys said, you know, I want to sell my art at reasonable prices. And I said, great. Why do you want to do that? He said, because I couldn't afford art and I wanted my art to be affordable. I said, okay, which is most important to you, surviving or having your art sell at low prices? He said, well, surviving. I said, you can't do both. You have to get enough money to have enough margin, enough money left over that you can pay your bills and pay for your advertising and pay for things. I said, I appreciate that. And it's a really wonderful thing to be able to help people like that. But keep in mind that the goal here is that you're trying to make a living. And if you're going to make a living, you've got to be fair to yourself. You've got to charge a price that is, that the market will bear, but a price that is going to help you make enough money. And if you sell them for low, low prices, you're going to have to sell 10 times as many paintings. So if it's about survival, then let's figure out how to make enough money. Did I answer the question or did I not? I can't remember.
No, I think you did, because you added to what you had said a little bit earlier. Here's kind of an interesting one. Both Sue Nocera and Ina Geister sorry if I mispronounced that, had similar types of situations where the galleries that were handling their paintings are closed because of the lockdown. They had shows about to start. All the paintings are still in the galleries. What should they do to, what's the best way to creatively market their art that's kind of currently held hostage by those closed galleries?
Well, first off, when it comes to galleries, I have a belief, and some people will disagree with me, but I have a belief that you should try to be in at least three different galleries in three different regions. And the reason I believe that is because at any given time, one or two of them could go bad. The galleries, there are very high quality galleries. There are galleries that are shysters and some of them don't pay their bills. But most of them are high quality. But the problem is that, you know, we had a period of time in America not too long ago where parts of America were doing really well, but other parts were not doing well. So if, for instance, your gallery was at the time in Detroit, Michigan, and that was your only gallery, you were in trouble. But if you had a gallery in Silicon Valley where people were spending loads of money, you were better off. So I like to spread my risk. I like to spread it into areas with different economies. I would even go so far as if you can get into a gallery in China. Now they say the luxury business in China is dead, so that might not be good advice now, but 6 months ago it would have been. This is highly unusual. The galleries will open back up again. Some of them won't survive though. So you wanna make sure that you have a dialogue with the gallery directors about how you can get your paintings. If you can get them out now, it might be a matter, hey, would you leave them on the porch and I'll be there at 2 o'clock? Or it might be a matter of I want to know that if you're not going to make it, that I'll get my paintings back. And I go into a lot of this stuff in my art marketing stuff, but you want to have a contract with every gallery. Now, there are some galleries where they insist on being the only gallery, and that's okay. I know galleries that do that. And it's okay as long as they're selling for you and they're consistent and you trust them and they've been in business for a while. But be careful. Just remember, if anytime you have all your eggs in one basket, you know what can happen. I have a question from somebody here, Dale. It says, the economy's dead. I can't imagine people buying any art when they can't pay their bills. Their 401k is cut in half. Isn't it more realistic to realize that art won't come back for a few years, if ever? Well, maybe. I think I think it will come back. It may not come back in the same way or as fast, but remember, there are always rich people who will buy art, and there are always people. That's why I say focus on rich people, because you know, if somebody's got $100 million in the bank and they get hit hard, they still have $50 million in the bank, right? So go after where the money is, and that's why, you know, we have 310 billionaires that read Fine Art Connoisseur. That's why I went after them, because I thought, I want to be able to go to my advertisers and say, no matter what, you're going to sell paintings. I have an advertiser who tells me he sells a $60,000 on average from every ad he runs. And he sells $200,000, $300,000, $400,000 paintings. But he averages it out. Now, quite frankly, it not all the readers are billionaires. A lot of them are wealthy people. A lot of them are regular people. And so there's a nice mixture. But the idea is that I try to go and stand in the river where the money is flowing. Dale?
Perfect. I'm going to do one more question. All the rest of the questions are a little bit more personal in nature, maybe things that we could follow up with offline and send some emails. But the last question I've got is from Julie Trail, manager at Gallery 10. And her question is with respect to how to get inspiring some of her artists to promote their work online and to do their part in promoting their work and selling some works.
Did she say she's a gallery?
A gallery, yes. Manager of Gallery 10.
Yeah. Well, I think first off, the spirit of that is correct. Julia?
Julie Trail.
Julie. So Julie, we have the same issue. We have 400 art instruction videos that we've created with probably 150 or 200 different artists, maybe more. And some of those artists refuse to promote. Some of those artists are big promoters, and we're in the game together. And there's kind of some have an attitude of, it's your job to promote, not my job. Some have the attitude of, I want to help you in any way I can, and it makes a difference. What we try to do, we don't always do this, is we try to give them very specific instructions and guidance when possible. So let me give you an example. When we are promoting the Plein Air Convention and we have this faculty of superstars, we will send them an email and say, would you be willing to post this icon about you being at the Plein Air Convention on your Facebook page tomorrow? So we're taking the work and doing it for them. They just got to take the icon and then upload it to their Facebook page. And we sometimes will say, hey, you might want to say this and link, put these hashtags in or link to this. We never say do this. We say you might want to. And by doing that, we're engaging them to help us, but we're not creating a lot of work. If we send them, we tried this. We sent some of our artists a list. We said, okay, here's a marketing list of the 500 things that you need to do on your side. We're doing 15,000 things. You do these 500 or these 50. And nobody did anything because, you know, they opened that email once, they forgot about it. So if you spoon feed people, I think that is the best way. And just understand some of them won't promote you. Now, if those artists sell well, stick with them. But if they don't sell well and they're not promoting you and not working with you, move on to artists who will, because life's too short. Okay, so I have a question. It says, is it okay to barter my paintings in exchange for goods and services? Absolutely. I see no reason not to, but you want to make sure that you're bartering at least dollar for dollar or two to one. And keep in mind that any painting that's sitting in your shelf or your garage that is not generating income is not serving you. If you have paintings in your house and they're not hanging on the wall of a gallery, or if they're not hanging at a local restaurant to expose you, those paintings are not serving you. And so put every painting to work. If you can barter some paintings for some goods and services, I see no reason why not. You know, most of us don't have a shortage of paintings. I got thousands of paintings, well, maybe 1,000 paintings hanging out at my house. Most of them aren't any good, but I have some paintings that I could probably put together a small show, or I could go to somebody and say, hey, I'll give you three paintings, you know, worth $6,000 in exchange for $6,000 or even $12,000. You know, I'll give you $12,000 worth of paintings in exchange for $6,000 worth of whatever. I think that can work to your benefit. So, you know, there's a lot of things that you can do bartering. Dale, how are we doing on questions? Are we towards the end?
Yeah, I think any other additional questions, like I said, they're a bit more personal in nature, things that I'll follow up with directly. So I think we can safely move on and okay. Talking about some of the exciting stuff.
All right, I think I had one other question. Let's see here. No, I guess we've covered them all. Okay, so I've got a couple of thoughts that I just want to share with you, and then I've got a real special offer. Hang around for it, because you'll regret not hanging around for it. You want to be proactive now, because time is of the essence. There's no better time than now. I really believe this is the best time in history to get attention, because you've got people at home. You can find a way to reach them. They're spending more time with their magazines, their social media. This is a great time. Reach them now. You've got to hit the level of intensity. Work harder than ever right now. This isn't a time to be on vacation. This is a time to really build your business. Keep in mind, the economy is about to restart. You want to be ahead of that, so that people are aware of you and starting to see you frequently. And it may take them a while to get to the point where they're going to start spending money. But you know, when you go through that slide that we talked about, I'll find it here real quick. Let's see, you go through this slide here. Can you see the slide? Yeah,
yep, so we can see it.
Yeah, well, you go through this slide, just remember this startup period is you're not getting a lot of sales in the startup period anyway, so you might as well do your startup period while people are not thinking about buying anything, so that by the time they're in the market, they're ready to buy something. And so think about the power of repetition. and how you can use that to your advantage. So anyway, we want to be proactive. You don't want to stop business as usual. You know, you don't want to be sitting around. You don't want to lose your momentum, because we talked about momentum leads to bankruptcy. You've got to still start rebuilding your lost customers fast. And you got to start before others get a big advantage on you. This is a time to get a big advantage. And those of you who are beginners, you need to invest right now in learning art marketing and studying it. Those of you who are old salts, just know that there are new things that you can learn and that you can grow. So I'd like to tell you about a special opportunity. And I talked to you guys about a cash surge. This is a cash surge. I have a business and I need to raise money for my business, and you're going to benefit from it. So I've done all these art marketing bootcamp videos. They're, I think, about 3 or 4 hours each. I've done social media marketing secrets with Lori McNee. I did this one, how to quit your job and become a financially successful full-time artist. That's for people who have retired, people who have people who are starting out, people want to quit their jobs, and then these other boot camps. Plus, I have boot camps that I've never released. A 2019 boot camp in Santa Fe, I never have released that. I've got that on video, and I have my art marketing book. I'm going to give you an offer for all of it, but I want to show you this. All of these.
Eric, can you quickly share your screen? Do you mind?
Oh, I'm sorry. I forgot to do that, didn't I? Okay. Well, nobody's going to see that, are they? Okay. So
there we go.
Anyway, I talked about all these art marketing boot camps that I've done, and one that I never released, which is new information. And this is a webinar only offer. And that, what I mean by that is this will never appear on our website. It's not going to be anywhere else. This is to raise money for coronavirus. I'm willing to give up a lot because I need to raise money right now, and it's going to help you. This total package, if you were to buy all of these, is $1,600. Most people tell me, look, Eric, which one do I start with? And I always say, you got to start with number one, and then you got to go to number two, and then you got to go to number three, and so on. You really want them all. And well, they'll say, well, you know, if I could only spend, you know, $200 or $300, which one should I get? And that's a hard one to answer. So, but this is like $1,600 worth of stuff. Some people buy the whole set, and we've sold tons of these. Today only for webinar guests, we're selling this to you for $350. And it's because we're trying to raise some cash, just being honest with you. And it also is going to help you a lot. You're going to get what? 36 hours of video plus my book. All of this is digital, which means you get it instantly. And you're going to save $1,100. I've never done an offer like this before, and it's only because of coronavirus. So we're not offering this anywhere else. It's just for the webinar guests. And the way to get it is artmarketing.com/offer. So the first step is to tap the link, fill out the form, insert your credit card, and there's a timer, and you got to do it before it expires. Dale, if we can pull up the page just to show everybody what that looks like, and then they can figure it out. There's no obligation to do this. We just want to help, and we'd like to have a little help. So this is what you're going to see. There's a timer at the top. You get 15 minutes. You can click the green button if you want to buy, and this is today only $350 price, $1,100 savings. And if you scroll down, you can, you know, you don't have to read all this, but you could scroll down, and there's a sales letter in there that tells you everything about it. But if you go to the bullet points, Dale, this just some of the stuff you're going to get. Quite frankly, if you get one idea out of this, it's worth more than $300. You think about $300 is two couples, if you're lucky, going out to dinner and having a couple bottles of wine. You know, it's really not a lot of money. Sell more paintings, how to get higher prices, how to sell in a really horrible economy, how to get art galleries to invite you in, how to get more sales from existing buyers. That's huge. That's going to make up 30%, 40% of your business in the future. I have people who just use that one thing that I taught them, and it's doubled their business. How to advertise properly, how to use social media to your benefit and the giant mistakes most people make, how to take extra action in a bad economy, how to become nationally known, how to get invited into top art shows, how to get consistent cash, how to do cash surge, which is what you're seeing now, how to make other top artists reach out to get to know you, how to become a local art celebrity, how to generate sales without selling paintings, how to make paintings sell more paintings. Yes, you can use your paintings to sell more paintings. That's something nobody's ever taught. How to sell paintings in person, although how to make that and do it comfortably. How to make personality styles work to your benefit and what they are. How to get write-ups in top magazines and so much more. Now, Dale, there's even more bullet points down here of the other things that are inside all of this. We're trying to eliminate the idea of starving artists, but you know, how to identify and map out your ideal life as a full-time and financially successful artist and a proven path to get there. How to prepare for success by setting your goals properly and then to actually achieve them. But it's not the way everybody thinks. How to develop and implement your personal brand so your name is automatically associated with high-quality art and high prices. Proven strategies for getting invited into the higher-end shows and festivals. You know, things like Prix de West and things like that. How to use social media to build a following of loyal followers who will spread the word like wildfire. How to raise your prices and increase demand so you're making more and selling more. How to develop a strategy for strong, consistent sales throughout the year, so you never have a slow season, you know, so you don't have these gaps. How to identify key collecting trends and capitalize on them with your own work, getting huge surges of sales. Dozens of secrets that will help you double your sales every single year for the next 5 years and beyond. The single easiest and simplest way to set and achieve your financial goals as an artist. The most effective tools and tips and tricks to sell your artwork online at premium prices. The insider secrets to getting invited into the best art galleries. A sure way to sell more of your work at every event. How to become a local and national celebrity so your name comes up when people think about buying art. A foolproof method for selling more seats at your next workshop. How to build a secure future so you have a predictable income and can focus on creating your art. How to attract the best collectors and get them to pull out their wallets. How to advertise your art the right way so you have a consistent funnel of buyers every month. How to make ads that generate more sales leads. Do this right and you'll always have people looking to buy your work. Why stories are the secret ingredient to higher ticket sales and how to craft them perfectly. How to get an advantage with your art gallery so you move more paintings out the door at higher prices. The deadly mistakes artists make when they try to advertise and how to avoid them. Why getting inside their heads and understanding personality types is important. And there's so much more. Anyway, Dale, we can go back to my slides. And anyway, this is an offer that this is what you're going to see. You just buy that button. It's normally $1,500 worth of videos. Today, because of my cash surge need, I'm offering it to you for $350. I've never done this. I'm not going to make this a public offering. This is only for people who view the webinar. And so this is something that this website disappears when that timer goes away. It disappears. And so you have an opportunity now. Dale, let's go back to screen sharing here. So I'm going to share my screen and go back to my slides. So anyway, you go to artmarketing.com/offer. There's a link. There should be a link. Step one is to tap the link, fill out the form is two, and insert your credit card, but do it before the timer expires. And so I just want to reiterate to you everything that's in there. This is my life's work. I have helped so many artists, and I'm so proud of that I've watched. I can tell you artists that are major brands today that you know their names that use this system to get there. And this is the system. If you invest the time, you've got the time right now, you get these digital videos today, you can start watching them today. Before we go back to work, you will have everything. It's kind of like my encyclopedia of art marketing. It's everything that I know. I mean, it's very up to date. There's very great stuff in there. There's a couple things in there that may be a little bit old because I did them a while back, but not very many. And even if you have one or two of these, you're getting the rest of them. And plus the boot camp that's never been for sale. We're not releasing that anytime soon, maybe never. And so that's 3 days, 3 hours, or 3.5 hours of boot camp from last year, including how to sell on Instagram. This one idea that will generate $300 is worth the price for this. This is going to change your life. I can't just say that loosely. I don't want to say it and try to deceive you in any way. I have had literally hundreds of artists tell me that this has changed their life. You want to use this now to gain an advantage, to learn marketing, whether you're a gallery or an artist, this will help you. You can grow your brand bigger than ever, and you can become a nationally well-known brand. Now, you've got to be able to paint, you know, but we also know painters who are big brands that sell a lot who can't paint as well as some of us can. So, and you have to ask yourself this too. What happens if you don't take action? Are you going to look back on your life and say, I wish I had taken a chance. I wish I'd have gone for it. You know, I have a friend, I don't want to use names. So I have a friend, I've been coaching him on art marketing. He doesn't do anything I tell him to do. And it's been 10 years and he's in the same job, making the same amount of money, making no progress. And if he had done these things when I told him to do them, he'd be making $100,000, $150,000, $200,000 a year, probably more. So today only for our webinar guests, a $1,693 value. It's only $350. I'm giving it to you for a savings of $1,100. Just tap the link, fill out the form, insert the credit card, and do it before it expires. You know, I'm going to turn this off right now and then come back to you live on video for a second. I want to thank you guys for tuning in. I know I value your time. You've been taking a lot of time to sit here. And I hope that these principles, it doesn't matter if you buy this right now. I'd love for you to, because it'll help me and it'll help you. But it doesn't matter. If you just employ the 7 or 10 basic principles in there, if you get really aggressive now, get yourself visible now, it'll make a huge difference in your life. But if you will invest in yourself, I constantly invest in myself. I read, I have stacks of books. I read probably a book and a half or two books a week. I invest in online courses. I'm taking two or three online courses right now that are not painting. I invest in my painting. I want to learn and become a better painter. I'm constantly investing. I try not to spend my time wasted. I try not to sit around watching television and spend all my time on social media. I'm trying to grow. And that effort has really helped me. It's helped my family. It's helped my business. My business isn't in very good shape right now, but it has nothing to do with me. And quite frankly, I went and used some of these principles and took action, and I got 1.7 million views of our videos. It's never happened in the history of art video. Never has happened in that history. 1.7 million views because we took aggressive action. And you know what? I'm working harder than ever. I'm working longer hours than ever. And I'm making a fraction of what I've been able to make in the past. I got 3 kids going into college and I'm scared to death. I get it. And I know we're all scared to death, but I can't sit there with blinders on, standing in the hurricane and hoping that the hurricane will go away. I have to take action, and you need to take action for yourself, for your family, and for your future. And this is a gift. I'm giving you an $1,100 discount. It's a gift. I don't discount these videos. I'm not going to put these. If you go to the website where we sell them, you're going to pay $157 a piece for them. And yeah, you can pick and choose, but you know, you get 2 videos. You've paid the price you're getting for all of them. So I'd like you to consider it. It's not going to make any difference to me one way or the other, but I'd like to help you. And I think that we all have to take action. Now, my rule is this: I don't ever want to take food off your table. And if this is going to take food off your table, don't do it. Don't spend the money, please. You've got your family to think about. You've got to survive this. So don't do it. If you got a little extra money or you got a stimulus check coming in and you're going to blow that on a TV, blow it on something that's going to help your career, because that'll make a huge difference in your life. And that's what this is all about. You know, I'm a big family guy. I got triplets. I have 3 kids that are going into college at one time. You know, all along I had to buy 3 bicycles every time they grew into a different bicycle. I had to, we went through 50,000 diapers when those kids were little. This is all about your family. This isn't about me. This isn't about other people. What you're doing is for yourself and for your family. Maybe you don't have a family. Maybe you just want to live that dream of an artist. But I'll tell you something. I don't want anybody else controlling me. I don't want a boss. I don't want a boss telling me I can't go on vacation. I don't want a banker telling me I don't have enough money to go on vacation. I want to be able to live the life I want to live. I don't care to be a rich man. It's not a, it's, I have friends who are rich men that are, and women who are miserable. I have friends that have jets and who are billionaires, and some of them are happy, but some of them are miserable because they're the lifestyle that they live, they have had to completely make massive sacrifices. I am loving this time with my family. I'm loving that I don't have to be on an airplane. And I'm going to get on an airplane less, and I'm probably going to do less, fewer events in the future because I just love this time with my family. And my kids are going to college, so that may change things. But this is about your family. Don't take food off the table, but if you have to stretch a little to do this, don't buy them if you're not going to watch them. Don't buy them if you're not going to take action. There are things in here you can do even if you don't have advertising money. There are things in here you can do. There's a concept which is you can spend time or you can spend money. You can spend a lot of time and spend a little money, or you can spend a lot of money and spend a little time. Now, there are times later in your career when you want to do both, but you know, ultimately you want to spend less time. I recommend that you spend 20% of your time on your marketing, no matter what, no matter where you are in your stage of your career, unless you're not trying to sell paintings anymore. But as long as you're trying to sell paintings, you got to be visible and you got to spend time on marketing. In the beginning, I recommend you reverse it. Spend 80% of your time on your marketing and build it out because it will serve you well. You'll get that momentum. It'll keep growing. But if you start getting momentum and then you stop, you're going to do this. And if you lose momentum, you risk going bankrupt. You risk having to go back to a job that you don't want to be in or working for a boss you don't want to work for. I worked for some pretty horrific bosses in my life. I don't ever want to have to be in that situation again. That's what motivates me. That's what keeps me waking up every day and saying, you know, I am willing to work hard to learn and grow. You have to learn and grow because the world changes constantly. You have to stay on top of this stuff. But if you do, it'll serve you well. So I want to thank you for your time today. I hope this webinar has been helpful. I want to encourage you. This will all be over. This will end. We don't know what's going to happen. We don't know if the economy will bounce back fast or not, but you know that luxury items are always the first thing to go and the last thing to come back. So you want to gain your advantage now. Get out there, get ahead of it. We want you to survive and we want to help you in any way we can. So thank you so much for watching. Dale, thanks for your help today. And
thank you, Eric.
Guys, remember to go to the webpage. Dale, the webpage is, tell me again what it is. It is
artmarketing.com/offer. Do you mind pulling up that slide? There's a lot of people asking. I'm trying to respond to comments as quickly as I can, but yeah, leave it on that slide for everyone for a couple of minutes.
Yeah, I will leave it on that slide. And so
there we go, in the green right there, artmarketing.com/offer.
Yeah, is what so we're looking for. All you got to do is go to that page, tap on the link. You can read everything that's there. It'll tell you everything that's there, but you know, tap on the link and you can go ahead and buy it. And by the way, I'll offer 100% refund. If you watch every video and you feel like you didn't get your money's worth, I'll give you 100% refund. I am so confident. I mean, it, quite frankly, if it were $1,693, I'd still give you 100% refund. That's how confident I am in this. So tap the link, fill out the form, insert your credit card. Dale, do we have PayPal or anything like that on there?
Sorry, that's a good question. I'm not sure if we have PayPal on that particular site, but I'm going to post in the Q&A a link to our head office, and then maybe we can work something out for those people
folks,
who aren't able to do that.
Please do not share this offer. I don't want this out in the marketplace. This is for you who attended the webinar. It's my gift for attending the webinar. It's designed to help you because you're serious about your art career. please don't share this link. There are a lot of other people who will pay full price and come in and pay full price, and I need them to do that. And it's not that I'm not willing to share it. If they come into the webinar, I'm willing to share it, but I'd rather you not share that link. And when it expires, it's supposed to disappear. So, and then we're going to take the link down. So please, if you're interested in this, do it today. It's a great deal, $1,100 savings. It's just, I've never gone this deep. And quite frankly, I would never go this deep if I didn't have a situation where I needed all the help I could get. And if it's going to help you and it's going to help me, it's a win-win. But if not, that's okay too. I hope you got something out of this webinar. But remember, there's a 15-minute limit on the page and then that page expires. Is that right, Dale?
That is correct, yes.
Yeah, okay. Well, I don't know how many people we had, but I think I noticed we got very close to our 1,000. If we may have hit 1,000, I don't know. And I'll give you guys my email address. My private email address is B as in boy, Eric, E-R-I-C, Rhoads, R-H-O-A-D-S. You can see the spelling on the book. Everybody puts an E in it. You just don't put an E in it. The E goes in the front. It's R-H-O-A-D-S. And it's at Gmail. And also, if you want to follow me on Facebook, it's Eric Rhoads Publisher. You can follow my personal page, but I can't follow you back because they limit that to 5,000 people. And if you want to follow me on Instagram, it's Eric Rhoads, or LinkedIn or Twitter. I'm on all of those. And I'd love to know more about you. And so thank you for tuning in today. I really appreciate it. And, you know, this has been a really interesting time, hasn't it? It's been an opportunity to learn and grow. I should mention to you that you're probably aware of this, but if you're not, every day at 12 noon on Facebook Live on the Streamline Art video page and on the Eric Rhoads Publisher page and my personal page, I'm going on every day live at noon to give an update, and we're giving away prizes and stuff. I'm not giving away these videos, by the way. And secondly, every day at 3 p.m. Eastern, we're doing an art marketing segment. Some of you have dropped off to go to that, but please know that that's going to be replayed. And every day there's something during coronavirus. So we're going to keep doing that as long as we're in quarantine, wherever you are. And if you're around the world, drop me a note, say something. I'm sorry I don't have time to answer personal art marketing questions one-on-one. I try once in a while, but it's pretty tough, especially now. But I'll try. If you do it on Facebook, it's better because that way other people get the benefit of learning from the answers on those. And so go on to the Eric Rhoads Publisher page or Eric Rhoads page and do it there. And we also have artmarketing.com has dozens, if not maybe hundreds of articles I've written on marketing, and probably all of them are valid. Maybe a couple are no longer valid, but I've been doing that for a few years. And so this is a resource to help you. So I really appreciate, you know, half of you have spent the whole time, have stayed here the whole time. And so thank you for your time today. Remember to go to artmarketing.com/offer. Do it now because this is going to disappear. $1,693 in value. It's all coming to you digitally. And that way you can watch it immediately during coronavirus. If you want this offer and you want to do it on DVD, email me, beericrhoads@gmail.com, and I'll put you in touch and we'll extend the offer to you who want it on DVD. It costs us a little bit more money to serve that, but I'm happy to do it if you don't do digital. And but that's got to be today. So save $1,167, tap the link, fill out the form, insert your credit card, and do it before the timer expires. I'm going to hop off now. I hope you guys have a really great day, and thank you for watching. And I'm really honored that you would spend time with me. Thanks. Bye-bye.